The main battle tank is one of the most potent symbols of a nation's military power, a terrifying armored behemoth capable of challenging any enemy it encounters on the battlefield. They are some of the most advanced and dangerous machines modern nations produce, but they aren't all created equal. Competition to create the deadliest, most sophisticated tank in the world is intense, and the stakes are high. Battlefield dominance is the proving ground of geopolitical power, and a question of life and death for the crews inside these weapons. With the US and China ratcheting up tensions, it's no wonder there's a lot of discussion about how the military hardware of the two powers stacks up against each other. The United States has been the world's sole superpower for decades and has been accustomed to overmatching anything its adversaries can put into the field. But China has undertaken an incredible modernization of its armed forces, and its capabilities are constantly growing. The two nations boast some of the most formidable tank designs on the planet, the M1 Abrams and the Type 99. But how do these two designs compare to each other? The Abrams has by far the older design lineage. Development of the original model began in the mid-1970s, seeking to upgrade the American tank force to compete with the advances in Soviet weapon designs. The original M1 tanks first entered service in 1980, though their capabilities were then a shadow of what they are now. The M1 has seen a long series of upgrades over the decades, each one adding new technology and making the tank far more lethal, as well as adding considerable weight. Chinese tank production has for many years drawn very heavily from Russian designers, and the Type 99's predecessors were clearly modeled on the Soviet T-72. In recent decades, though, they've developed more and more of their own original technology, the quality of which has been improving rapidly. The Type 99 first entered service in 2001, and the upgraded 99A was officially introduced in 2015. All information here pertains to the latest version of the tanks, the M1A2 for the Abrams and the Type 99A. First off, let's consider the size of these monsters. The Abrams is the larger of the two tanks at 26 feet long, not including the main gun barrel, by 12 feet wide and 8 feet high. The body of the Type 99 is 3 feet shorter, and its profile is about 5 inches lower. The Abrams is also significantly heavier. Each major upgrade has added weight, and while the original M1 back in 1980 weighed in at 60 tons, the most modern version of the tank weighs nearly 74 tons. The latest Type 99A tank weighs just under 64 tons. Both tanks carry engines that supply 1,500 horsepower, but the lighter overall weight of the Type 99 means that it achieves greater power-to-weight ratio. This is borne out in the top speeds of the two tanks. The M1A2 can travel at a maximum speed of 42 miles per hour on roads and just 25 miles per hour off-road. The Type 99A can travel at nearly 50 miles per hour on road and over 37 off-road. It also has greater fuel efficiency and a longer operational range. The Type 99A can travel about 311 miles before needing to refuel, whereas the M1A2 can only travel up to about 265 miles by road or about 124 miles off-road. The greater operational range and the faster tactical maneuvering are clear advantages for the lighter Chinese tank. It shouldn't be assumed that these would necessarily lead to a greater survival rate in a battle between rival tank formations, given how sophisticated the weaponry and targeting computers of both machines are, but it's clearly a mark in the Type 99's favor. Next, we'll consider the armor of the two tanks. The ability to withstand enemy fire is one of the original and most fundamental requirements of any tank, and armor protection is one of the fiercest areas of competition in tank design, as well as one of the most secretive. The original M1 Abrams models were protected by Chobham armor, a British-designed composite originally developed in the 1960s, which combined ceramic blocks, metal plates, and empty space. The complicated physics of how these diverse materials and their careful arrangement interacted with an incoming projectile meant that the armor could withstand shots that would have easily penetrated simple steel plates. Over the years, the M1's armor has been repeatedly upgraded, and the most recent generation of M1A2 models incorporate depleted uranium, in addition to other unknown materials. The exact composition is highly classified. Depleted uranium is extremely dense, and the improved armor makes the M1A2 significantly heavier than previous models, but the protection is greatly increased. Estimates are that the depleted uranium armor might be nearly twice as effective as that of the original M1s. After the US military's experiences of urban combat during the Iraq War, the Tank Urban Combat Survival Kit, or TUSK, was released. This allows the Abrams to be outfitted with explosive reactive armor, in addition to other upgrades designed to give the tank more of an edge in the constricted fighting environment of towns and cities, where it's much easier for an enemy to sneak up with a man-portable rocket launcher. The Type 99 is also protected by composite armor panels, but again, the composition and configuration are closely guarded secrets. It's been claimed that the tank's frontal armor protection is roughly equivalent to that of the Abrams, but this is impossible to verify. It also benefits from an advanced explosive reactive armor system, said to be similar to the Relict system designed for latest generation Russian tanks. Small explosive panels are installed on the surface of the tank and detonate when struck by an enemy round, theoretically disrupting or even destroying it before it can penetrate the tank. The explosive panels can defeat a wide range of anti-tank missiles and also diminish the penetrating power of armor-piercing tank shells, but the full extent of its capabilities are unknown. So which side actually enjoys the advantage? It's impossible to say at this stage. Of the two tanks, only the M1 has seen combat against enemy armor in the two invasions of Iraq, but there it fought against older Soviet-era models, which were clearly outclassed by the Abrams. Neither the M1 nor the Type 99 has to withstand the fire of most cutting-edge enemy weapons, and both sides are determined to keep the full extent of their armor's capabilities secret. Next up, the big guns, the teeth and fangs of these beasts of war. The M1A2's main weapon is the M256A1 120mm gun, a smoothbore weapon designed by Germany's Rheinmetall AG and manufactured in the US. This is the same gun that was carried on all but the most modern incarnations of the German Leopard 2 tank. Its maximum effective range is nominally 3,500 meters, though it demonstrated in Operation Desert Storm that it could engage targets at nearly 4,000 meters. The Type 99A carries the ZPT-98 125mm gun, a copy of the Russian 2A46M, which has a maximum effective range of 3,000 meters. For both tanks, the primary anti-tank munitions are what are known as armor-piercing fin-stabilized discarding sabot rounds, which is a technologically very sophisticated round that consists of a long, thin penetrator with fins on the rear, surrounded by a thick sleeve that falls away from the penetrator as it flies toward the target. This makes it possible to fire a very thin projectile, which otherwise would be very unstable in flight, from a smoothbore barrel, which allows greater forward force to be imparted to the projectile. The Abrams makes use of a depleted uranium round, taking advantage of the extreme density of that material and giving the round more penetrating power. However, the Chinese are said to have developed their own depleted uranium round as well, and they claim it can penetrate an M1 at up to 1.4 kilometers. This is, of course, unverifiable. Current estimates are that the M1's main weapon can probably penetrate about 15-25% more armor, an advantage for the Abrams, though clearly the Type 99 has a dangerous bite of its own. Both tanks can make use of a variety of other ammunition as well, including sophisticated high-explosive anti-tank rounds, anti-personnel rounds that scatter huge numbers of metal balls across a wide swath like a giant shotgun, and more. The Type 99 is capable of firing Chinese, Russian, and ex-Warsaw Pact ammunition, giving it some versatility and supply. It can also fire anti-tank guided missiles down the gun tube, which the M1 cannot. These missiles are effective over a longer range than a tank's normal armor-piercing rounds and can even take on low-flying helicopters. However, the technology has been around for decades without being extensively used, and probably doesn't represent a major advantage over the Abrams. The M1 employs a fourth crewman as a manual loader, whereas the Type 99 uses a carousel autoloader, which can achieve a rate of fire of around 8 rounds per minute. A well-trained human loader is faster, at least under ideal circumstances, though the autoloader could potentially perform better in rough terrain, where the human could be jostled and his loading cycle potentially disrupted. But the autoloader is a complicated piece of equipment in itself, and is one more piece that can fail if not properly maintained. The consequence of the Abrams carrying a fourth crewman as a dedicated loader is that the turret is larger and heavier than that of the Type 99. This adds to the overall weight of the vehicle and decreases speed, but also comes with some major advantages. The US military feels that the human loader is faster and more reliable than an autoloader. Also, the larger turret means there's room for the ammunition to be stored in separate compartments fitted with blowout panels, so that if the tank is hit and the ammunition is ignited, the rounds will explode out of the tank and not into the crew compartment. This is a significant advantage in the survivability for the crew. If the Type 99's armor is penetrated, there's a greater danger of the ammunition cooking off right there in the crew compartment. The M1's fourth crewman is also available for other tasks on board the tank, or to fill in when another crewman is injured. Both tanks carry several secondary weapons for use against enemy infantry and light vehicles. The M1A2 carries three machine guns, two on top of the turret in front of the commander's and loader's hatches, and one coaxial with the main gun. The Tusk upgrade kit adds another coaxial 50-caliber gun, The Type 99A carries one coaxial machine gun and one on the commander's cupola. So the Abrams, which has been used extensively on battlefields where the main threat was enemy infantry like the insurgents of Iraq and Afghanistan, carries more secondary firepower. This is an advantage against infantry but doesn't tip the scale against the enemy tanks. Both tanks carry an extremely sophisticated suite of sensors and targeting computers, capable of taking the readings and crunching the math to put rounds on target at long range while moving over rough terrain, so that the gunner just has to keep the weapon aimed at the enemy vehicle. They both also carry active protection technology designed to disrupt the guidance systems of enemy anti-tank missiles. Both the US and China have been experimenting with so-called hard kill systems, which fire small projectiles at incoming warheads, but too little is known about the capabilities, especially of the Chinese technology, to compare effectiveness. Finally, it's worth bearing in mind that the cost of the latest generation M1A2 tank is around $9 million apiece, whereas each Type 99 costs only around a third of that price. This isn't a mark in favor of the Type 99's survivability, but it is an important strategic level consideration. If one had to bet on the tank that would come out on top in a one-on-one match, the best money right now is probably on the Abrams, given the American tank's advantages in firing range, armor penetration, and loading time, and its proven combat effectiveness over decades of operation. Too much about the Chinese tank's capabilities remain unconfirmed rumors at this point. But the M1's edge, if it indeed has one, is clearly too small for comfort. The US military itself considers the Type 99 to be a world-class design and a clear potential threat to its own tanks. Many of the capabilities of these cutting-edge machines remain shrouded in secrecy, and the question of which tank would dominate the other will likely remain unanswered unless they wind up facing each other across the battlefield. But one thing that is clear is that both will undoubtedly continue to become more lethal over time.